Good evening. We are on the sidelines of the IPPAI Aviation Watch 10th Annual Regulators and Policymakers Retreat 2009. And with me is the chairman of the Central Electricity Regulation Commission.
Regulatory Commission,
I stand corrected. Dr. Pramod Deo. Welcome to the show, Dr. Deo. So we'd like to know, what is the CERC and how does it help develop the power sector in India?
Central Electricity Regulatory Commission is a central commission because we have a federal system, what we call as a quasi-federal or quasi-unitary, whatever you may call, but we have a state governments and the central government. So the result is that electricity is the subject which falls in the concurrent list, which means states and center both have jurisdiction. So with the result that all the matters pertaining to electricity within a state are handled by State Electricity Regulatory Commission, and center deals with interstate matters. That will be in simple way of putting it. But I won't go into more complicated. But our role really is now we want to develop a national market for electricity. Because till now we were in a situation where we had state monopoly and also the central monopoly. We had giant electricity companies like NTPC, NHPC, Power Grid, who developed the central generating stations and also the network for that, for interstate transmission of electricity. Whereas at the state level, we had state electricity boards, and they were vertically integrated because you had generation, transmission, distribution.
Absolutely.
And a common man always comes in contact with distribution, and he has all problems with distribution.
Right.
Now the idea of a market is that the consumer had no choice.
Right.
The consumer had to buy electricity from the state electricity board.
Right.
There were few exceptions like city of Mumbai, Ahmedabad, Surat and Calcutta. Mm-hmm. Where we had some private players, but their role was also limited. Now, unlike in telecommunication, people are really impressed by what has happened in telecommunication. The demand has gone up for telecom and the prices have come down.
Absolutely.
The similar thing is to happen. But what happened in telecommunication was that you had choice of suppliers. So in the same circle, you had more than two, three suppliers, and then once the wireless in local loop technology came, the prices really crashed. But in electricity, you can't have parallel networks. So only possibility is that you can share those wires. And if somebody owns a wire, doesn't mean that he has a monopoly. Subject to capacity availability, he has to share. And like when we use any toll road, we pay toll charge. A similar model applies there. So from the day one of the new electricity law, which came in 2003, what it envisages is that transmission will have a complete open access, and at the distribution level, consumer will have a choice. And when you say consumer will have a choice, it doesn't mean a very small consumer can, and maybe in future it will be possible, but we are talking about 1 megawatt and above consumers. Mostly they would be industrial and big commercial consumers. They can decide who their supplier will be. That means that suppose today you are in Goa and your electricity is being supplied by Goa Electricity Board or Electricity Distribution Company. That doesn't mean you have to buy electricity. You may find that the cheaper power is available in across in Karnataka, in Belgaum, maybe from biomass plant. So you can buy that electricity and you have to pay certain charges, and those charges also have been detailed. So that is the idea though. Once you have this kind of choice, then there will be competition and the prices should come down.
Right, sir. Sir, given the recent reports in media, there have been reports that state governments have been moving to block the open access to electricity, which means that they are denying consumer choice, in a sense. So how does this really play out and what are the economics of it?
Well, the economics is very simple. Because the entire new electricity law is premise that there will be plenty of electricity. And once you have plenty, then you can have competition, choice, markets can function. But when you have shortages, then you are dealing with an economy of rationing and shortages. So our role is not to ration electricity. we cannot do that. But many of the state regulatory commissions have to perforce do that. And the state government find that there are huge shortages. Now, once you have a shortage, you have this mentality that no electricity shall flow out of my state, so that my consumer, that itself defeats the very purpose. But this is really the reason for this kind of a distortion which is taking place. And they have been trying to invoke various provisions in the law which may not be very correct, but then real reason for that is shortage. And we have today electricity market. Yes, a small market. Only 4% of the electricity which is today being used in the country is being today traded, either traded through trading license holders, or we have got two power exchanges, third one is about to start. And also there is another method called that unscheduled interchange or exchange of power. So you will find that nearly 44% is being done through what they call as UI, another 40% or something like that. So we are looking at 6% on the power exchanges. So naturally the prices on power exchanges are so high. So it's like that today on the TV they show, because of the failed monsoon, the vegetable prices have gone to 100 rupees, 60 rupees. That's something similar thing is happening. Because at the election time, there were state governments who asked their utilities to buy, they were state utilities, they bought purchase power for 14 rupees. So that has created the problem.
It's because there is a monopoly on wires which are used for transmission. And despite the fact that even though generations opened up quite a while back, transmission was also opened up. But still, private sector has not come into transmission, and transmission continues to be a government monopoly.
Not really. What has happened is that the transmission, because earlier the power grid was the only interstate. After that, we have now policy to encourage something similar to ultra mega power project, big transmission projects to be given to licensees. And we have already given one project for the western region to a private company. More important is that was not strictly based on a competitive tendering basis. But now we have an empowered committee, and one of my members heads that committee. And that committee's role is to identify these projects, and then competitive bidding will be done by the financial institutions involved, like based on that. So now they have already identified three such projects. More such projects will be identified, and based on that, competitive bidding tenders will be awarded, and then the private players will come.
Right. So, with respect to the Electricity Act 2003, and this is my final question to you, the government has recently proposed, or it is rather considering, an amendment in the Section 11 of the Act, which it is believed is widely misused by state governments to deny open access.
Well, today, the Joint Secretary, Shriyan Kavale, he spoke and he said, if need be, we will go for amendment. Because prima facie it appears that there is no problem with Section 11. Its interpretation doesn't seem to be very correct. And because of the shortages and the high prices, state governments have tried to use it and say that no power can flow out. But if the power is flowing out of one state to another state, as I explained to you under the Constitution, it is the jurisdiction of the Central Commission. It can't be of the State Commission. So how can or the state government? Appropriate government, if you are talking about which has power, it will be central government.
Right.
So if this matter is in the high courts, and then it could finally go up to Supreme Court if the need be, it will decide, and that's what Shri Kavale said. We will get Solicitor General's opinion, and we are referred it to Law Ministry.
Exactly. So just one thing before we leave. Why is it that we send these issues of litigation to courts, you know, normal high courts or civil courts, I mean, which have a basically civil background, when we should actually be routing it through expert courts or, like, you know, appellate tribunals, which are very focused in this particular sector?
See, what happens is, high courts have original jurisdiction. So many times this provision can be invoked, saying that it is a question of interpretation of law. Whereas the appellate tribunal does not interpret law as such. So say that this is something against the Constitution, that some provision in the law. Against that you can go. So unless High Court decides, finally we have had many cases, the matter went up to Supreme Court, the Supreme Court has decided the right interpretation, and then that becomes the law of the land.